So for today, I want to talk about products of functions and trying to figure out when can we write a function as a product over its zeros? What do we need to do about this? I want to try to develop the theory almost spontaneously. Now, this is, of course, hard when you've taught the subject many times. So I have deliberately only skimmed my notes to have some rough idea of what I want to talk about so that this is somewhat fluid. I want to try to give you a sense of how do you attack a problem you don't know. Okay, so the goal is to describe a function from its zeros. And the questions, of course, will be, how well can we describe the function knowing its zeros? How unique will it be? Well, we've talked in the last class that if you know the zeros of a function, let's say you have a function that doesn't vanish anywhere in the complex plane, does it have to be one of our friends, the constants? So you have a function on all of C that does not vanish. Must it be constant? No. What could it be? It could be e to the x, could be e to the z. It doesn't really matter what letter we use to write the complex variable, but if you use x, we will laugh at you, we will make fun of you, and we will embarrass you in public. It's fine. Now, it'll only detect what I'm saying, so I think your identity is safe, and I will not publicly say who you are. Okay. Let's think about always going back to the real case. So real case, say, zeros R1, R2, dot, 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 Rn. I do not want to use the letter z to denote zeros in the real case. Then the function must be x minus R1, dot, 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 x minus R2, up to multiplication by a constant. Now here what I'm doing is for the roots. The roots are allowed to be complex. Okay. Roots can be complex. Is this correct, or do I need another assumption to say that this is my function? So if I have finitely many zeros, whoops, should be an Rn, does that uniquely specify a real valued function up to a constant number? No. What could I put in? Yeah, I could also put in, can put in e to the x squared, and that won't introduce zeros. Amazingly, every now and then, there is something similar between real variables and complex variables. It does happen. So if I just know the zeros, I have the ability to put in a function of the form e to the x squared. The question becomes, what other functions can you put in, especially if you start to require more and more conditions about your function? Okay? So now the question becomes, if it was a polynomial, if function is a polynomial, different story. So now, if the function is a polynomial, then we have f of x is a x minus r1, x minus rn. And if I know the zeros, I know the function up to a multiplicative constant. And in fact, I can get this multiplicative constant if I know the value of f at one place where it's not zero. So just need value at one place where non-zero. And once we get its value at one place that doesn't vanish, then we know its value everywhere. All right, so then the question becomes, you know, how does this carry over to the complex case? And more generally, what if it's not a polynomial? So the real question is, what if there are infinitely many zeros? So that's going to be the main question we're going to concern ourselves with. How do we describe a function that has infinitely many zeros? We want to have some kind of factorization. Well, whenever you have a factorization, you always want to know, does it converge? So we're going to be dealing with products, because we want to represent our function as a product over the zeros. We want to generalize these formulas from, you know, the real cases that we've seen before. Now, I'm not going to get into the Newton identities. Hopefully you've seen that. If not, I'll put links in the additional comments. If I give you a polynomial like this, clearly I can multiply out and I can get the coefficients in terms of the roots. The question is, well, can you go backwards? If you know the initial polynomial, can you figure out the roots? And I'll let you ponder something like that. It's very useful for many purposes to have a factorization of your function into a product of its zeros. What happens if we have infinitely many? We're going to have to deal with an infinite product. What will be useful? Logs, right? As soon as you can be half asleep, if you hear me say product, you should immediately be thinking logs. There's also a reason why this section is following the section on logarithms. We needed to introduce the complex logarithms. So believe the complex log will be useful. And remember, the log of 1 minus z is equal to negative z plus z squared over 2 plus z cubed over 3 plus z to the 4th over 4 plus dot 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 if the absolute value of z is less than 1. This is a really good formula. The series expansion, we already have this in the real case, and because this matches in the complex case, it's going by analytic continuation going to be the same for the whole set when the absolute value of z is less than 1 in the region where this converges. We're really using points of accumulation, and this is going to be one of the key concepts in today's lecture. So let's study prescribe. I'm horrible at spelling. Given a set of zeros z1, z2, z3, build a holomorphic function on C, 0 here and nowhere else. And I'll put in if possible. It may not be possible. I may be asking you to do too much. When you've taken exams from me, you see I have no issues at all with asking you to do too much. But just because I want to do this does not mean I can do this. Is it possible to build a function with a set of zeros at these points and no other? What do we need to avoid? Need to avoid points of accumulation. So better avoid point of accumulation, or the function is identically zero. So we already have some constraint on the sequence we can look at. We cannot have a sequence that accumulates. So if the sequence can't accumulate, what's the only thing that can be happening? I've got to have infinitely many points and it can't accumulate. What can you tell me about the sequence? I'm sorry, it's spread out. Let's be a little bit more specific as to how it spreads out. I could make a pun about how the Indianapolis Colts spread out their special teams on the 4th and 3. And now I can somehow justify showing that clip as the additional comments. Yes?
It lies in an unbounded set.
It's got a lie in an unbounded set. And in fact, given any radius, there can only be finitely many z's whose absolute value is that large or smaller. Otherwise, we would have infinitely many in some ball. The ball is compact. It would accumulate. So conclude, the absolute value of zn goes to infinity. And let's order. So the absolute value of z1 is less than or equal to the absolute value of z2 is less than or equal to the absolute value of z3. Is my ordering unique? No. We unfortunately can't impose a really nice standard order on the complex numbers. But what I could do is I could make this unique by saying, let's order them by absolute value. And if I have two with the same absolute value, I start at theta equals 0, and I start going like this until I hit. And if I do something like that, then my zeros can be uniquely prescribed. I can also have multiplicities. I could have one zero occurring 2015 times. That's fine. Each zero will occur a finite number of times, and the absolute value of the zeros have to be going off to infinity. So the question is the following. Can I just look at the most natural thing? F of z is the product, n goes from 1 to infinity, of z minus, say, zn. So does everyone agree that this is my candidate function? What do you think? Is this a good function? For non-physicists, non-economists, mathematicians. Yes?
It's not going to converge because it's not going to want the thing you're multiplying.
Okay, so the first question is, we need to understand when products converge. Because if you take the log of a product, the log of a product is the sum of the logs. If you want a sum to converge, the terms have to go to zero. Is that enough to force the sum to converge? Not even close. But it's a necessary ante to play the game. If you have a sum and the terms don't go to zero, you have no hope of it converging. It seems reasonable that the same thing should be going on here. And the analog of a sum with terms going to zero in absolute value is a product with quantities going to one in absolute value, because the log of one approaches zero. So this is looking very difficult. If you specify what z is, because the zn's are getting very, very large, eventually all the z's will be more than z plus 1. So all of these quantities will be greater than 1. If you want, you can say eventually, for all n greater than or equal to n, z minus zn will be greater than or equal to 2. Because the z's n's are going off to infinity, and z is fixed. So this product will explode when you put in a value of z. There's only one way to maybe save yourself. If I put in z actually equals one of the zeros, the product will be zero. But if z is not one of the zeros, then the product explodes. So product does not exist if z is not in my zero set. Great. So the only places where this product converges are the places where I forced it to be zero. It converges nowhere else. This is not good. Can you think of something we could do to maybe make these factors better? Weight them. So the question is, what's a good way to weight them? One possibility is we could try to rewrite it. Maybe g of z is the product n goes from 1 to infinity of 1 minus z over zn. This is going to have the same zeros as this. But the advantage now is these zn's are going to infinity. So when zn gets really, really large, these factors look like 1. Is this what you meant by weight, or did you mean put in another factor each time? We could also do h of z is the product n goes from 1 to infinity. We could do z minus zn, and we'll call this maybe, we'll do wn for weight. And we'll have some function over here for each n. And the idea is, well, this is blowing up. So maybe we introduce some extra factors to decrease these. What can you tell me about these functions wn? They should be going to zero somewhat quickly, and maybe the speed of which they go to zero depends on zn. So goes to zero with zn. So the speed is going to depend on zn, which makes sense. You're depending on how big this factor is. If this factor is really huge, I need to weight it by a very small number. If this factor is only huge, what else do we know about these WNs?
Non-zero.
Non-zero, good. Why are they non-zero? Then we would introduce. So, not necessarily.
Not zero outside of the
set. So not zero outside of the set we care about, but we really don't want to worry about maybe this is zero at one of the other Zs because we want to preserve multiplicities. So let's just make these functions non-zero. All right, we need a function that's non-zero, Any candidates? Yes.
E to something?
Yeah. Try E to the something. Because we know E to the something will not be zero. So that's a really good thing to try. So again, I'm deliberately not preparing today's lecture. I want to try to get a sense of how would you attack something you haven't seen. And to try to think, what are the logical things? How would you build up a theory? I'm skipping the beginning stuff about Jensen's inequality and all that stuff. You know, you can go back and read that. I want to try to develop, how would we start getting our tools? Which would you rather use? This product or this one? This one? This one is a lot simpler to use, but it gives you a lot less freedom. So one of the big things is, you know, having these extra parameters at your disposal. This gives us nothing to play with. So the question is, will this product always converge? Or will it be a function of the z's or the zn's? So this then leads us to discussions, when does a series converge? I'm getting much better at, you know, how to do these walkings. Okay. So what we want to do is we want to consider products. Does the product n goes from 1 to infinity of 1 minus z over zn always converge for any sequence zn with the absolute value of zn tending to infinity? Yeah, that's the very natural question we're looking at now. What would be a really good choice of z to use? And do not say 0, I will not let you use 0. I'm sorry? I want for z. What's a good choice for z? Right, try z equals 1. No matter what value of z you choose, you could always just rescale all the z's by that factor. So let's just adjust things to make z equals 1. So let's study z equals 1. This is a nice normalization. Otherwise, adjust the zn's. So again, the goal is to try to get a sense of what's going on. So we want to look at the product n goes from 1 to infinity of 1 minus 1 over zn. And we want to look at different choices. So let's consider two of my favorites. We'll do the product n goes from 1 to infinity 1 minus 1 over n. And we'll do the product n goes from 1 to infinity 1 minus 1 over n squared minus 1. Now, if you have two infinite products, how do you understand an infinite product? So how would we understand an infinite product?
Turn it into an infinite sum.
One thing is to turn it into an infinite sum. But we'd like to avoid the infinite if possible. So how can we avoid the infinite? So how, instead of working with an infinite sum, you often work with what?
A
finite sum, and then you take a limit. So, yes?
Should it be from n equals 2 to
infinity? Yeah, let's do it from 2 to infinity, you're right. Thank you, yes. So for a lot of problems like this, let's look at a finite product and then take the limit as we go off to infinity. So if we're doing a finite product, we'll go up to big N in both of these cases. Now in the first case, this is the product n goes from 1 to big N, we get n minus 1 over n. And in this case, we get a product n goes from 2 to n, n squared minus 1, minus 1. So maybe I want so this is going to give me n squared minus 2. We'll do this way. So we get, I'll put a plus sign here. This will just make the algebra a little bit nicer. And so now if I do this, I'll get n squared over n squared minus 1. So we have two different products. What can you tell me about this product? Yeah, we can do even better than telescoping. Basically, what should we do for this summation range? Or the product range? If we start at n equals 1, this is a boring product to evaluate. Because if we take n equals 1, for the same issue we had over there, it's 0. So let's bump this one up from 1 to 2 as well. Let's study things that are not identically 0. So now if we look at this, now it's telescoping. So we'll get, when n equals 2, we get 1 half times 2 thirds times 3 fourths. So this is going to be 1 half times 2 thirds times 3 fourths, dot, 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 times big N minus 1 over big N. It's telescoping. And this equals 1 over N, which goes to 0. So this product here is going to converge to 0. If we look at this one over here, we've got 1 plus 1 over N squared minus 1, so we've got N squared over N squared minus 1. Now, this one is going to be the product, n goes from 2 to infinity, n times n over n minus 1, n plus 1. Just factoring things nicely. And so this product becomes, when n equals 2, we get 2 times 2 over 1 times 3, 3 times 3 over 2 times 4, 4 times 4 over 3 times 5, 5 times 5 over 4 times 6. Am I doing this correctly? Now, if you look at what goes on, the 2's cancel and the 3's cancel. The 3's cancel and the 4's cancel. The 4's and the 5's cancel. If you keep doing this, this factor that is left at the end is going to converge to 1. This will converge to 2. So this actually converges to 2. So in this case, everything's going to be fine. Now, I have this 1 minus 1 over n. This is the advantage of being at the blackboard. What would happen if I put a plus sign here? So if I put a plus sign, instead of having a product of n minus 1 over n, I have n over n plus 1. So if I put a plus sign, it goes off to infinity. So the product n goes from 2 to n of 1 plus 1 over n, this is going to go to infinity. So in one case, it's going to 0. In another case, it's going to infinity. In another case, it's going to 2. We can have wild behavior when we look at these infinite products. And if you think about what's going on, it really comes down to how far away are we from 1. So all of these, it's a product of 1 plus a small correction. This one, the correction is negative, so we're below 1. Well, if we're below 1, what's an upper bound for this product? 1. Okay, so clearly this product is not going to go off to infinity. Now, unfortunately, these factors are all greater than 1. They're not much greater, but they're all greater, and when we take the product, it will go off to infinity. In this one, they're also all greater, but they're all greater by such a small amount, it's actually going to end up being a finite number. It's going to be 2. If you think about logarithms, the log of 1 minus z is negative z minus z squared over 2, minus z cubed over 3, dot, 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 dot. So if I take the log of 1 plus blah, it's approximately negative blah, okay? That means for this term, if I take the log of this product, let's write this out a little carefully. So we'll keep this on board because I do want to keep the log expansion. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take these and we're going to apply the logarithm. And when we apply the logarithm, the log of the product n goes from 1 to n of 1 plus an, I'm going to write this a little bit more generally, is going to be the sum, n goes from 1 to n, of the log of 1 plus an. And this is going to be the sum, n goes from 1 to n, and I'll get negative an minus an squared over 2 minus an cubed over 3 minus yada, yada, yada. If the an's are sufficiently small, the squares, the cubes, and the higher powers, the sums of these will be negligible. And the main term is going to come from the sum over here. And so we see in the first case, if an is 1 over n, it's going to blow up. If an is 1 over n squared, it's going to converge. So frequently, it's controlled by the sum of an. if finite converge, if infinite diverge. So let's think a little bit about what goes on. If we want this to have any chance of converging, what must be true about the ans? So if we want this to have a chance of converging, what must be true about the ans?
They're going to
be. Right. So for the product n goes from 1 to infinity of 1 plus an to converge, need the absolute value of an has to go to 0. If it doesn't go to 0, then there's no chance of having the product converge. So that's a starting point. The question becomes, how quickly must it converge? Well, here's the nice thing. If the ans are converging to 0, then eventually the ans are going to be less than a half. And what I claim is, if the sum of the an converges, then the rest of this tail will also converge. Because this will be no worse than a fourth of that sum. This will be no worse than an eighth of that sum, than a sixteenth of that sum. So if the sum of the ans converge, the sum of the an squareds, an cubes, and all that stuff, not only do they converge, but their sum converges as well. So if the absolute value of an goes to 0, eventually an is less than a half. So if the sum of the absolute value of an converges, then the sum of an to the k over k, and we'll have a sum, n goes from, say, big N to infinity, and we'll have k goes from 2 to infinity converges. And again, the reason is, at this point, because an is less than a half, I can just replace an to the k with an times 1 half to the k minus 1, dominate with a what? Dominate with a geometric series. So it all comes down to whether or not the sum of an converges. If the sum of an converges, the logarithm converges. If the sum of the ans diverges, it diverges. We have to be a little careful. And the care we need to be is that when we take a product, we're taking a product in a very special order. What kind of series convergence have you talked about in real analysis? Conditional versus absolute. So issue, conditional versus absolute. Who likes dealing with conditional convergence? Good. Who likes dealing with absolute convergence? Yes. So it's much nicer to just say, let's be in a situation where the absolute values of the ans converge, then we're dealing with absolute convergence. Nicer if the sum of the absolute value of the ans converge. And that will be true if and only if the product of 1 plus an converges. And we'll put in absolute values there. So you can begin to see why we're putting in the technical conditions we are. Okay? Let's do an example at this point. Can somebody give me a function that has infinitely many zeros? Thank you. I was really hoping I didn't need to prepare anything and that people would just shout out sine of x. There is another function you could have shot out. Yeah, but cosine is much worse. It's much nicer to work with sine of x. It's what all the good mathematicians do. All right, so let's do sine of x. But of course, we realize it can't be sine of x because this is a complex analysis class. So it should be sine of z. And then we realize we don't want to do sine of z. We want to do sine of pi times z. Why would we want to do sine of pi times z? Because this now forces the zeros to be at the integers. Okay. So we have 1, 0 at 0. And then the rest is we've got a product n goes from minus infinity to infinity of z minus n. So I will put a big question mark here. Does this work? Will this product converge? It'll converge at the zeros. Will it converge at any other place? No. We're doing the fundamental sin. We have a product, and it's not of the form 1 plus something. So this is a stupid thing to do. Well, we'll keep the question mark because we're going to try something else. Instead of doing z minus n, what should we look at? So we should do now n goes from minus infinity to infinity of 1 minus z over n. Should that converge? Do you expect this to converge? Is this the same as what we've done before, or is it a little bit different? There's a difference between this and what we've done earlier today. What is the difference? Yeah, the bounds. This goes from minus infinity to infinity. Everything else we did went from 1 to infinity or 2 to infinity when you correctly observed that I was multiplying 0 by things, and that's not really worthy of our time. So this goes back to improper integrals from calculus, right? And you know, when does something like that exist? We had the Cauchy distribution. This is an aside for people who've taken probability with me. The density is 1 over pi, 1 over 1 plus x squared. And if you want to calculate the mean of this random variable, you would multiply by x and you take the integral. If we take the integral in a symmetric way from minus a to a and take the limit as a goes to infinity, this will exist and it will equal 0. But if we go from minus a to 2a of x, 1 over pi, 1 over 1 plus x squared dx, and take the limit as a goes to infinity, well, the integral from minus a to a cancels. We're left with the integral from a to 2a. If x is really large, x over 1 plus x squared is about 1 over x. The integral of that is going to be natural log of x at 2a. So when the dust settles, this should converge to the natural log of 2 divided by pi, which does not equal 0. So the way in which you calculate this improper integral matters. Now, everybody who is anybody wants to calculate it in the symmetric way. But for the improper integral to exist in calc, we need it to hold no matter how we approach infinity, no matter how we do the bounds. This is the difficulties. We want to avoid something like this. When we look at this, z over n, does this make you happy or terrified in terms of convergence? Terrified, good. Why are you terrified? And I'll try to walk you through it. Yeah, it's the harmonic series. We've got a 1 over n. When you think of something that diverges, you know, other than these stupid examples of like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which eventually we'll see sums to negative 112, you know, you want something like the harmonic series. This is our prototypical go-to example of a series whose sum diverges. I am deliberately trying to have this class fit perfectly with what we're doing in probability today, where we'll be doing geometric random variables and the harmonic series. And we'll be playing with toys from Happy Meals. So when we look at this, we're worried. Is there anything you can do to improve the convergence of this? We could do something else. So let's take the limit as n goes to infinity. Oh, and of course, I'm not writing this. We all understand n does not equal 0 now. Let's do the limit of the product n goes from minus n to n does not equal 0 of 1 minus z over n. The advantage of doing this now is I can pair the 0 coming at n with the 0 coming at negative n. So if I have n equals 5 and n equals negative 5, I get 1 minus z over 5 and I get 1 plus z over 5. So this turns out to be the same as z times the limit as n goes to infinity product n goes from 1 to n of 1 minus z squared over n squared. And this is from pairing, you know, 1 minus z over n and 1 minus z over negative n is 1 minus z squared over n squared. So now if we do this, we can really improve the convergence. Now we have a product of 1 minus z squared over n squared. Well, it doesn't really matter what z is. If z is some finite number, so is z squared. If you want, just consider z squared your new z. And now we have the ans look like something of the form blah over n squared. That's going to go to 0 very rapidly. We know that series converges. And now we actually expect this product to converge. Do we expect that this product equals sine of pi z? So do we think that this is the same as sine of pi of z now? Oh, no, I need to keep this. So we want to look at the sine of pi z versus z product n goes from 1 to infinity of 1 minus z squared over n squared. This has the same zeros as the sine of pi over z. It's a nice exercise to show that the only time sine of pi over z is 0 is when z is an integer. So we're going to use, I'll just put this up here, the sine of pi z is e to the I pi z minus e to the minus I pi z over 2i. Only zeros are at z is an integer. And what you can do is you can see that, look, if z has anything, you know, if I write z as x plus I, y, if y is not 0, these two factors will have different absolute values. The absolute values of these factors are controlled by the imaginary part. So if the imaginary part is not 0, this can't be 0. Well, if the imaginary part is 0, then it just reduces to the standard sine function, which we understand. So the only zeros of sine pi z are at the integers. Are these two functions the same? What do you think? Well, if they're not the same, how can they differ? So they could differ. How badly could they differ at these places?
They can certainly differ by a constant unless we fix a certain value.
So they could differ by a constant. Is there any value of z where we can evaluate this infinite product nicely? Sadly, that's the only place we can evaluate it, and that's how we do it. If we take the z over to the other side, now if you're writing it like this, there's an asymmetry on this left-hand side. We don't want sine of pi z over z, we want sine of pi z over pi z. Now, if I take the limit as z goes to 0, what does this limit go to? So this goes to 1 as z goes to 0. What does this product go to as z goes to 0? 1. So there's at least a chance now that this at least fixes the two functions so they agree in some sense. But they could differ by the exponential of a holomorphic function. So what we can conclude at this point is it does equal this. And then the claim or the conjecture is that g of z is identically 0, that these are actually equal. Okay, so there's a lot going on here. What we're leading up to is the Weierstrass product formula. And we're going in a circuitous way to get there. But I want to try to get a feel of how you look at these products. Question? Well, I'm saying if I now look at sine of pi z over pi z, what does this expression go to as z goes to 0? 1. So I never before had that the sine of pi z actually equaled this. If they were equal, then you're absolutely right. I would have to have a 1 over pi here. But when we were looking at these expressions, all we were able to do is we were able to say that in the limit, I guess I should propagate the question mark doesn't maybe propagate downward like this, but we'll propagate it. We don't know that this equals this. We just know that if we want to write a product over zeros, if we do things symmetrically and take a limit, this is a really good way to write the zero product. But it doesn't mean that it actually equals this function. It just means that if this limit exists and converges, which it does, it agrees they have the same zeros, but we don't know about their values anyplace else. And in fact, we do have trouble precisely because of this pi factor, is that we're missing a 1 over pi. We should really have sine of pi z equals pi z times this. Is the sine of pi z over pi z holomorphic? Holomorphic, yes or no?
Yes.
As z goes to 0, the sine of pi z, its Taylor series expansion, is going to just be pi z. So as z goes to 0, in fact, that's why the limit equals 1. It doesn't blow up. It's a removable singularity. You know, the stuff we did on removable singularities comes now back to help us. So we have this wonderful product expansion. The product expansion converges. And what we're saying here is there is no need to do anything to fix the product. The product converges on its own. We don't need to introduce these weight factors. They used to be over here. That's why I'm still pointing here. They're long gone. But we had introduced those WNs. And the whole point of those WNs is that given a generic sequence, we may not know that it converges. Is it possible to always choose a sequence of WNs so that things will converge? And we want to do it in such a way that we don't change the multiplicity of zeros, we don't add any zeros. And that's where these E factors from the book come into play. Okay? Any questions on what we've done up till now? So in the case of sine, this is not a proof. There is a way to make this a proof by looking at a cotangent formula. As an aside, there's a lot of really good number theory lurking here. If you want to start expanding things out on this product, if you expand this infinite product out, you get 1, then you get minus the sum of z squared over n squared, and then you'll have other things. You can actually, from this, isolate out the formula for the sum of 1 over n squared. This is known, I believe, as the Basel problem. Euler solved this, got pi squared over 6. We'll see later in the semester that because it equals pi squared over 6, there are infinitely many primes. And two people in the class should be smiling on this one. Okay? So let's think a little bit about the general product. We're not always going to be in a situation where we can manipulate things so nicely to get our products to converge. We want a general formulation. Now, when I try to write a general function as a product over its zeros, there's more than one way to do it. And what we're going to do with Weierstrass's method is we're going to overkill. The goal is we want a function that's holomorphic, that has the same zeros, the same multiplicities, and nothing else. At this point, we are not looking for the simplest exponential factor for them to be off by. So if instead of having sine of pi is equal to that, if I had it equal to e to the z squared times that product, I would consider that a success. And so what we want to do now is we want to put in an extra factor to make things converge. And we're going to use a really nice trick that, if you have a sequence that's going off to infinity, eventually it's greater than 2. Okay, so consider, z1, z2,
z3, double dot, the absolute value of zn goes to infinity. Eventually, say n greater than or equal to n naught, have the absolute value of z over zn will be less than 1/2. Now this choice of index n naught is going to depend on z. But because my sequence zn is going to infinity, no matter what z you give me, if z is fixed, eventually this is going to be less than 1/2. And the whole point of this is that when I want to do my series expansions, things are going to be nice. So we're going to define a couple of functions. We're going to define e0 of z. try to use the same notation as the book. Right, so they're going to just do this as 1 minus z. E1 of z will be 1 minus z, e to the negative, I'm sorry, I think I want e to the positive z. Yes. E2 of z will be 1 minus z, e to the z plus z squared over 2. E3 of z will be 1 minus z, e to the z plus z squared over 2 plus z cubed over 3. And I think you get the point. Ek of z will be 1 minus z, e to the z plus z squared over 2 plus yada 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 plus z to the k over k. So we're just taking more and more terms up top. What does this numerator look a lot like? I'm sorry?
Log expansion.
Almost.
With a minus sign.
With a minus sign. So this looks a lot like the negative of the log of 1 minus z. Okay. Why would we want to write this as the negative? Well, let's just play with math. 1 minus z, I can write this as e to the positive log of 1 minus z. I can do that so long as z is not too close to 0. Or so z is not too close to 1. You know, if z is small in absolute value, I have a logarithm. When we look at this, we're not going to evaluate this at z. We'll probably put in z over zn. We'll put in our different zeros, and we'll multiply all these together. So now, if I look at ek of z, this should be approximately e to the log of 1 minus z times e to the negative log of 1 minus z. Is it exactly equal to e to the negative log 1 minus z? Is this exactly the negative of the... No. It's close. Okay? Let's just pretend it's exactly equal. What would we get?
1.
So, if this was actually the negative log of 1 minus z, then we would have that ek of z is just 1. Product of 1 is going to be no problem. And then just if we studied the product, you know, n goes from 1 to infinity of ek of z over zk, that should hopefully converge. And it should hopefully have the same zeros as what we want, because we have this 1 minus z over zk outside. Now, of course, this is not entirely correct, because if this function is identically 1, we're not going to have zeros anywhere. The point is it's not identically 1. The point is it's close to 1. It's going to be 1 plus something small. And because it's 1 plus something small, the hope is that when we look at this product will make sense and will converge to what we want. Okay. So that's the main thing we're going to try to do, and we're going to have to finish this, unfortunately, in tomorrow's class, is the difference between this and like negative log of 1 minus z should be like z to the k plus 1 over k plus 1. Plus, you know, some extra bits. But essentially, it should be of size z to the k plus 1. Well, if this number is less than a half, if I'm raising this to the kth power, that's going to be extremely small. So the error is going to be error of order z to the k plus 1 over k plus 1. And because we're going to plug in z over zk for all values that are sufficiently large, that's going to be like 1 half to the k plus 1, all good. You know, this is going to be fine. It's going to converge without any trouble. All right, so we'll finish the details on this tomorrow. This is one of the times where it's better to teach a Tuesday, Thursday version of this class, so we could finish this all in one day. But there's a lot of concepts here, so it's not bad to just pause here, go home, and think about this.